this person's friend. And then I heard something from someone else on the same team, and I just painted the team. Like, this team has a cultural problem. And maybe it's just one person, but that is where things start to get really tricky, I think. Because, you know, I don't remember what the next slide is. I'm afraid to check. There's a few things going on with this. One, other teams don't need any inspiration to want to beat you. And stuff that goes up online, they use it. It goes boom, up on the board. Am I over? Is this overtime? It's a countdown, okay. And I think, you know, it reflects poorly on the program. It's like if you had a fundraiser at the mall or something, and you had a couple people, that's what this slide is, I think. Nope. This is the thing. Here's the comments area. Great race, except for the bad egg on the shore. Disgruntled former rower at busted.edu. So, and that's where these things were, and it was at the very bottom of this forum. So, you go to this mall, and it's a bummer. Like you have someone on your team, and they're wearing a Rowing Sucks shirt all the time. It's like, after a while, it's just kind of a drag. So you go to this mall, and you have some kids wearing these shirts, and you're trying to, maybe you're doing an ergathon or something like that. And then two guys go off, and they're running around in the Victoria's Secret playing tag. And so the people who you're trying to get to give money to you, you're walking, and they just think, they're like, no, not those guys. So, and I think it's this, and as a coach, you'd be like, got enough with that. And I think it's the same thing in the digital space. And I think also, like, I'm going to take this down because it starts to get you after a while. And so other kids are negatively affected. You have, sort of have this thing going on all the time with your team that online. And so, and I also think, you know, college coaches are following this stuff for high school kids. Other teams are following this. Ultimately, employers are following these things. And they can really sort of start to haunt you. I think all high school and college coaches know. They get a couple kids who are real sort of negative types, and they start to think, maybe that program's not a good fit for us anymore. So, you know, I think, so this comes around to this idea that I think is worth starting to think about as part of what rowers do. One is, you know, everything you do is potentially exposed to a ton of people. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a lot of likes on this photobomb from Mike by the time we're done. And two, they can figure out who you are. But also, if we see good stuff, we see this stuff, and we think, we see good stuff, and we slowly start to think, wow, that's a kind of a cool program. These are cool kids. I might like to be involved with that. And so I think there's a little bit of a need in our community for digital citizenship, and this is my main point. And so I understand that coaches, you know, get people for 85 minutes, and they say, we're going to teach them, and we're expected to teach them this digital citizenship. Like, it's just another thing that we're piling on in the 21st century, and coaches are asked to do way too much now. But so my idea is, I'm going to get rid of this screen. I don't know what's next. I don't remember. Okay. So that you like to see, right? Like, you want to be part of this team. It's a bunch of kids. They gave them the team camera. They all jump off together on their trip to Florida. So some of the things that I see where I am is, first, when something goes a little bit haywire, first thing to do is take a breath. Sometimes I'll have, hey, pull that down. And it's sort of, it's not zero. I time this at 18.00.87. I'm on my last page. And so here's the things that, and so I'll just quickly, I'll do this. And, you know, second, one of the beauties of our sport is that we shove them off and they race. So, you know, these two things, my idea is to give them the reins. So you have a team blog. You assign it to a kid. The kid puts something up, and they have to think about, how do I want our program to look? You have a team Twitter. You give them the login. And a couple teams did this in Florida this year, and I was really impressed. And this is actually what made me think, this is what I would like to talk to people about. I was really impressed with how it turned out, because they gave the kid the Twitter, and they took their phone, And it looked like the best team in America. It's just a normal college team. They're just going middle of the pack. They come sometimes good, sometimes bad. It looked like one of the best teams you could possibly be involved in. You'll give them, and it can be a little hairy. You know, you give it to the wrong guy, and give them the Instagram account and say, you know, take photos. What's it like to get to practice every day? This is a little big brotherish, but you could follow them with the team account. Other people are doing it, so their employers are doing it. Their potential college coaches are doing it. So maybe it's not a bad idea. They think, you know, coach might see this. And actually the guy, this is not in my notes, but the guy who was the rec sport rower guy, he had a kind of a tough coach later. And he says now, he goes, in college, he had a little bit of a tough coach. He goes, yeah, I can still hear him on my shoulder trying to be the good angel. And that angel on my shoulder has really changed me. So, you know, keep an eye on them. And then, you know, or get a kid to give you an anonymized nasty post, find one for you, put it on the wall, and then see what that effect is. What do you start to think about that team? And so, all right. I'm way past. But so that was that. As all this data washes over me, I thought, what can we do about it as coaches? And maybe that's it. In the spot where, when you give kids responsibility, they tend to act more responsibly. So in the digital space, it could be that that works just the same. All right, that's it. Thanks for the extra time. How far did I go over? I'm just curious.
I put a couple extra minutes into the schedule before.
What do you want?
Because of Ed is our watcher. Ed sees all our...
Still on. Thank you.
All right, here we go. You guys are doing a great job. I need to get closer to Matt. Hi, here we go. All right, my word for Matt is lead. I met Matt this summer. Actually, what was it, the summer or October? It was the summer. This summer, I just happened to drive up there and I called him up and I said, hey, I think you're doing some really cool stuff. I see what you're doing up at Institute of Rowing Leadership, and you know, you're right there in Boston at CRI, and I just want to stop by and kind of hang. And he goes, yeah. And so I did, and it was great. He showed me all around, and I got to tell you, I walked out of there really impressed with what they're doing, not only with the Institute of Rowing Leadership Program, CRI as a whole. I've driven by that a bazillion times. I'm from there, and I'm up back and forth. But just being able, having a chance to go inside. But then there were all these other things that were so cool. I don't know, are you going to talk about the launch?
No, you go ahead.
They have all these new, crazy, innovative things up there. And as I left, my son and I left, like, that was really cool. That was like pushing the envelope of things. So as soon as I left, I thought, I need to have Matt come down and talk, because not only what he's doing there, but his outlook and his positive vibes that he's doing on stuff and the leadership he's putting up there. So, Matt Blair, you're on, buddy.
Okay. All right.
Hard up. Very good. Yay.
All right, everybody. Thank you very much. So my name is Matt Lair. I'm the Director of Coaching Education and Community Rowing. And the Institute for Rowing Leadership is our coaching educational arm that we run. So I'm here to talk a little bit about your team's greatest advantage. It might give a little away of where I'm going with that. But I think my story is probably similar to most of yours. I started coaching much more out of necessity than ability, like a lot more out of necessity than ability. So I went to college my freshman year, had a very charismatic guy say, hey, I'm starting this rowing team. Do you want to help me? And I said, sure. Never to know that would change my life path. And ended up rowing my freshman year after helping him sort of set up the team, and realized really quickly that we were better recruiters initially than we were anything else, because the next fall we ended up with 88 rowers and one coach. So that's how I started coaching. Hence a lot more out of necessity than ability. And was super fortunate to realize really quickly that I had no idea what I was doing. Thought what better place to go for me to learn than Boston. So I went to CRI and started coaching there part-time in the summer, and had a lot of really great mentors. Had a couple people who, actually one of my current colleagues, Ellen Misner, who is the coach for the U.S. Para team, and Ted Benford, who is the associate head coach at Northeastern for the men, were two people who I met super early on and were really kind to me. And honestly, like, my journey is I made a ton of mistakes along the way and didn't make any bad enough that I decided to leave. And I just kept trying to get better. I rode in lots of launches. I talked to lots of people. I tried to learn in any and every possible way I could, because that's the only way as coaches that we could learn, right? You had to sort of find your pathway, and it was unique for everybody. And that's why I'm so passionate about what I do today. And my job is to work with great people like you to help you be better at your jobs. So both at CRI, we've got a pretty intensive program that we work in, but also overall, we see the growth of our sport as beneficial for everybody everywhere. So if rowing gets better in Washington, D.C., that's better for us in Boston. It's better for everybody who's out in North Dakota who doesn't even know they want to start rowing yet. So I think we're in a really cool position. And for us, that all starts fundamentally with leadership, right? The big thing for us is that, you know, you all are leaders. Whether you want it or not, that's where you are. And how can we be better doing that? Because your impact on your team is super wide. So I'm going to bear with me. I'm going to have to jump computers eventually because of the internet. But as I said, you know, so my job is to help coaches be better. So your team's greatest advantage really is you. And the thing that's most interesting about when you think about your team is you're the only one who has a chance to impact every single athlete all the time. Right? Every time you talk to them, you have the attention of the 30 or the 20 or the 50 or the 80 athletes on your team. And as a coach, that's very different from anything your rowers do to improve. So you guys are here, so that's like a great first step in terms of wanting to be better. What I would say is that's not the only step you've got to take. And I've talked to coaches who say, well, it's one day. I can't miss one day of practice with my team. And my argument is, well, how can you not? Right? If your impact is going to be over your whole team, how can you not spend time making yourself better? And it's not investing in yourself if you're not taking the time to make yourself better. Right? And really, it's not a selfish thing it's the most critically important thing you can do for your team to make yourself better is to spend time working and learning and talking and being active, because you're your greatest advantage. And it's actually interesting talking with folks who are both in the coaching education world in rowing and outside of rowing. It's very typical that most coaches feel really guilty about taking time away from their teams, particularly in the winter. People tend to get away a little bit easier. But if it's any time during the year, people have a real worry about that, because they're worried about the negative impact. And, you know, I'll tell you, your team doing land training for one day versus you coming back fired up with not only great new ideas, but a great new network of people who you can call upon when you need it, those make all the difference in the world. And what I would encourage you to do is take time for all of your, wherever your network is to build that network, right? So, you know, we're fortunate, a couple of things we do. We have a monthly coaching education series where we bring in people who are non-rowing folks to come in and talk to the greater Boston rowing community. So anybody can come. We set up something once a month, and it's a great gathering spot. We do a coaching convention much like this on a little different scale, but same weekend as Crash Bees. We also have a one-year fellowship program, which I talked to Mike a lot about, where people come and they study with us for a year. So they spend, it's graduate school for rowing, and we're actually the only sport in the country that has that, which is crazy that that's, rowing is the only sport that has that, but totally true. So, you know, as a high school coach, what I would say, and for any coach, is the biggest thing you've got to know is, what is your filter? Why do you do what you do, right? You're clearly passionate. Rowing has clearly changed your life, and that's what you want to pass on. But why do you do it, right? And there's a whole bunch of reasons why you're going to do something, and that's going to be very individualized to you, and rowing fits in there somehow. So when you're thinking about what you do and all of the great sort of content that's going to come out of this weekend, how does that fit for you? So really, why does that fit, and then how does that fit? So as you look, oops, wrong one. Sorry, managing two computers. So these are two of the most successful coaches, almost inarguably in the last decade, plus in international rowing, Jürgen Grobler and Tom Terhaar. And I think one of the things that they both understand really well is, why do they do what they do, right? They want to make elite athletes go as fast as they possibly can, right? That's what they want to do, right? And your why is going to be totally different. Like, mine is helping people remove barriers to their success, right? And as high school, having been a high school coach myself, like, I know that those barriers are generally, you know, everything from family, academics, not even talking about performance, right? How many times have you had a parent say, hey, can you talk to Jimmy and tell him to do his homework, right? Like, because he won't listen to me, right? We've all had that conversation. Or they come to practice and you can't figure out what's going on, and then you found out that they broke up with their boyfriend or their girlfriend, right? Like, those are the things that, like, that's a very practical thing you've got to understand. And how you deal with that is different. But really, where you come from and why you do what you do, it's going to be different, but that's really important for you to understand what that is. So the thing that these guys do really well is, not only do they understand why they do what they do, but they understand how to do it, and how really is systems. So they've set up systems that work for them, and that's going to be different for each and every one of you. And it was actually having a conversation at lunch with a coach about this, is, you know, when you take stuff from a conference, you've got to distill it through your filter, right? What is your filter that works in your context, right? What works with your system? Because, you know, if you ask Jürgen and Tom, they'll tell you all the things that they don't have going for them. You know, Tom has the most advanced development system in the world, the U.S. university system, right? Like, he has tons of athletes that are developed at no cost to him. Jürgen has, I mean, in Britain, on your calendar that you buy at the store, the Royal Henley Regatta is on the calendar. Like, it's like the 4th of July. I mean, so there's a super deep access to rowing knowledge and rowing being important, and not to mention the unmatched athlete support those guys get in Britain. But those guys will tell you what their limitations are, right? And those are going to be different for everybody. So how do you deal with that, right? And that comes down to really practical ways. What sort of systems do you set up? So how do you spend the first 5 minutes of practice, right? Do your kids look at their phones, right? Are they like this, texting their friends, or maybe in the boat? I haven't heard the in the boat one before. But are they spending that time, or are they getting oars down? Are they doing their warm-up? You know, like, that was something Nikki talked about earlier. Her kids know, like, they go down and they do their warm-up, and there's a real schedule there, right? And how you spend that time and how you set up those systems goes a long way to saying, why am I here, and what does that look like for me? And even for you as a coach, right? Like, one of the things that I coach in the morning, so I'm a morning coach, so we start practice at 5 a.m. So one of the things that, as a system for me, like, I know if I don't eat breakfast, I'm super grouchy, like, the last hour of practice, right? That's just, and no one's happy about that. I'm certainly not happy. My rowers aren't either, right? So I make my oatmeal that I eat for breakfast in the morning for the week, and then I heat it up when I leave in the morning, right? Like, that's a system that works for me, and that helps me help people get over their obstacles, right? Because if I'm grouchy and I don't have a system in place and I only have my coffee, I'm awake and grouchy as opposed to awake and happy, right? So how that works for you is going to be very different. Your lens is going to be totally different. Maybe you have to share launches. Maybe you share, maybe you can only practice in a certain window. I know teams that, you know, they have so many kids that they share a launch. So someone has it from 4 to 6 and someone has it from 6 to 8. Or someone has it from 3:30 to 5:30, and someone has it from 5:30 to 7:30, right? So whatever your limitations are, you've got to know what that is, right? One of the things we found out at CRI that we can't post lineups on a bulletin board. There's too many kids, right? There's 80 kids trying to look at the same bulletin board. So we would lose 5 minutes a day, kids trying to get around a bulletin board, right? Which sounds really silly, but is actually something as a system-wide that made a big difference for us. So, you know, when you're thinking about getting your Crucero like these guys, what systems work for you are going to be different than what works for them. So it might take a little convincing still, like I totally get that, right? You know, so positive self-image and believing that you can do that makes a big, big difference. But I'd really challenge you to think about why you do what you do. Like, make yourself a note, reflect on it a little bit. Don't do it now, but really know that you've got to believe in it first, right? You've got to know why you're doing what you're doing, and then you've got to believe that that's why you're there, and then you develop your systems how, right? So if you're going to take stuff and you're going to look at the training program that Tom is doing, and you're going to bring that to your high school novice girls, like, that's not a one-to-one correlation, right? There's going to be pieces of that that might be valuable, but you've got to distill that through what works in your context. And also, you know, the other thing we ask athletes to do all the time is, like, believe that what we're doing now will help you in the future, right? Like, as a coach, you've got to have that same attitude, right? Like, we're in winter training. Like, that's what we're asking our athletes to do every single day. Like, this is going to make you faster in the spring, right? That's a conversation we've all had. So when you think about, you know, your efforts, it's not going to be a direct one-to-one-to-one. You're not always going to get it. But I'll tell you the three things in talking to coaches, and, you know, I talk to a couple hundred coaches a year probably, and the three things that they all do really well, the best coaches. First, they know why they do what they do. They know why they make their choices. So their choices may be different, but they know why they make the choices that they do. They understand their context really, really well, right? So what works at Washington College isn't going to work at Wellesley College, who's my neighbor. Right? They're two very different places, even though they're very much the same. If you look at, you know, the league they competed in and all of those sort of, you know, quantifiable ends, but they're very different places. And the other thing is they desire to learn, right? The best coaches are always looking for more ways to improve. They're always looking for a way to get a little bit better. So, okay, Homer, is Homer convinced you now maybe a little bit positive self-image, right? So contextually, you got to know what works for your context, right? So these are some of my contexts that I've worked in my 13 years of coaching. So everything from a skating rink, so this is old CRI, to a place in the top right, which would flood pretty regularly, so you couldn't have things on the floor, to the underground of a defunct restaurant. You can see the missing windows. And this was a boathouse that I worked at, that in the winter the walls didn't go to the floor. And in upstate New York, that's a really big problem, because it snows a lot in upstate New York. So the first thing you had to do was get everything up off the floor in the winter so it didn't freeze, and then you had to shovel out the bays regularly, right? So, and then, you know, and then my current place of employment, CRI, right? So things work differently in all those contexts, right? So I've been at CRI in two different places, and what worked at CRI before doesn't work at CRI now. And there's a lot of things that do work now that didn't work before. So understanding why you're doing what you're doing, and then how you're going to construct that. And then when we're talking about what you actually do on a day-to-day basis, now we're talking about actually talking to your athletes. What do your athletes experience? They experience the what. They don't experience the why. They don't experience how. They experience what you actually do and what those interactions look like. And this is where the rubber meets the road. So we're going to look at some what. So I'm actually telling you as a presenter to please get out your phones. We're going to have a little fun. This is good. Some of you already have them out. Which is good. So we're actually going to do a little fun activity because I figured with all of you guys being coaches from different places that are all of similar constraints, we're going to look at a little snap poll of what it looks like if all our connections work right here. There we go. So what we're going to do is this is a little instant poll. I thought it would be fun for you to see what people who are your peers are doing. So what you're doing is you're going to text to this number right here, 22333. And what we want to look at is what in the last 6 months have you done to improve your coaching? How many events have you gone to? So these could be you've come to rowing talks. So you all at least have to do number one, right? And so as you pick and text this number to 22333, you will see what happens. So this is when you actually have to start doing something too. So text the number, and you got two monitors over there, and hopefully you can see those numbers. So the top line is rowing talks is my one and only true love. which I think Mike would somewhat appreciate. And then 2 to 3 events. So there we go. Someone's figured it out thus far. This is good. I make coaching education events a staple of my diet. 4 to 5, I'm hungry for knowledge. And 6 plus, I'm a full-on junkie for coaching education. So just as I sort of share some of, you know, the things that have worked for me in different situations. So I worked at a boathouse, the one with the lack of window on the top floor. And we did a weekly coaches meeting. So all of the coaches came out for a weekly meeting. But much to my wife's enjoyment, we went to the same burger place every week. So I went to the same burger place for 3 years, which would have drove her mad. But, you know, I sort of just dealt with it because I wasn't the man in charge, and that was how it went. I worked at a place where we did 2 practices on a Saturday. So we would have breakfast in between practices. It was in the UK, so of course we had tea with our breakfast, not coffee. And we'd talk about what was going on. I mentioned a little bit, we do our regular coaching education series in CRI. Oh, look at this. Okay. Oh, look at this. 2 to 3. Oh, wait. Nope. Going down. Coming back. So it really is different, right? And I was talking to a coach a couple weeks ago, coaches in New Jersey, who said that they are now meeting up, and they just started this fall. They're meeting up once a week for lunch, which works great for them. You know, we found the after work thing works great for us. And what works for them is meeting after lunch. So the context doesn't matter, but building that community is super, super important. Okay, all right, ready for one more? Okay, this is the last one. We're doing one more poll. Oh, yeah, hold on. It's going to sleep on me up here. All right, so. Okay. All right. So this one is I use blank once or more a week to get better. So this one you can vote multiple times. So the first one you can only vote once. If you tried to swing the results in your favor, you found out that you couldn't do it. So this one you can vote multiple times. So reading, we're talking about books, magazines, websites. If we're talking media, we're talking videos, podcasts, webinars, community learning. That's if you get together with a group of coaches, rowing coaches or non-rowing coaches, and chat with them. Once a week, one-on-one conversation, if you're talking with a mentor or a mentee or just a colleague. And then the other one that I don't want people to forget about when they're thinking about regular engagement is personal reflection. I tend to do mine when I'm exercising. You might do it while you're meditating or walking the dog or if you've got a really long commute. I was hearing the commute over the bridge here is apparently pretty bad. So right, if you're going over the bridge, maybe that's your time to reflect. But taking time regularly to engage in it, that's what matters. If you do one thing a year, that's really great, and it won't have any impact. Like, it doesn't matter how great this weekend is. If you go away and you don't do anything until this time next year, you're going to lose that impact. You've got to regularly engage. Oh, good. Now we're getting some stuff. You're going to regularly engage with it. That makes a big difference, right? That's what is going to really sustain you, and it's going to fuel you as well, right? And that's the other part, is really fueling yourself through that is super important. Okay, I'll share all these later. All right, so I got to switch back over. So as you think about what those things look like, there we go. So we're looking at process, right? So identifying why you do what you do, right? So that's the number one thing. What systems, how are you setting up systems to make that work? And what does that look like? If I came to your practice, how would I know? Right, and if you're doing the what piece right, it's really clear to me why you do what you do. Right, so if you say academics are paramount, and then you come to practice and this kid, you know, just failed a test, and you let them go row, and because that's their release, then that's not bellying why, you know. And if you're rewarding kids for their academics, if academics are important, then that does belly your why. So that's just a little process for you guys to think about. One thing that I thought was super, super interesting that's always sort of stuck with me about coach preparation is in the run-up to the 2012 Olympics, GB did this study of all of their elite coaches and trying to win as many medals as they could. And what they found when looking at all their elite coaches is the more stressed out coaches were in their preparation, that had an 8 to 12% effect on elite athletes. Right? That's the world of half-percent gains, and it was an 8 to 12% effect. Right? So your impact on all of your athletes every day is really, really key. So invest in yourself, take the time. It's got to be regular, and you got to have fun with it. Okay? So would love to chat. If you've got ideas, we're always happy to share stuff too. I know we're getting to be a big producer of stuff. We're always super happy to share. So thank you very much. That was good. I did sneak a glance.
So while we change, if anybody has a question, Matt's going to stay for a while?
Sure. Yeah, I'll be
here. So Matt's here.
The only question I have is, why did Crash Meetings move this year between you guys and 1 week into our season?
So CrashBee's move this year, that's actually, so I'll put on my CrashBee board of director hat. So the CrashBee decided to move a little bit later because that's the time when people were doing more 2,000 meter pieces. Most people were saying they were doing 6,000 meter pieces that early, and they wanted to do 2,000 meter pieces a little bit later. It's a little more complicated than that too. In Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Vermont, all of the New England states and New York, public school break was always one of the two weekends. It's always the week of President's Day. So we had a lot of people who were conflicted on both weekends in February, so it moved to that last weekend in March, which clearly was negatively impacting you. It varies year to year. I think it is not unlikely, but it does vary year to year. It's in your season, yeah. Oh, interesting. Yeah, and our What Works Summit conference follows that, so it's the Friday and Saturday before. Yeah, bummer.
All right. That was great. Yeah. That was great, yeah. Coaching education.
Hey, Willie, how's it going? Excellent.
See, many ways. Willie's our coach, and we're his coxswains. We're like, point of what? What are you talking about? Yeah, okay, now he's laughing. Good. Okay. George and I have known each other 91, and for years it was digital. For years it was just email, and I don't think we met here.
Probably for rowing
right.
talks. Yep.
For rowing talks. But that time frame with digital, it was... I just published Nuts and Bolts, and George had published, where is it?
Down and Dirty Guide to Cochran. Mm-hmm.
And so we were kind of like these two rebels. I don't know if we knew our cause, but if you look at those materials compared to some of the books that are out there that are very typical about rowing, they're both different. Wouldn't you say? Mm-hmm. They both kind of take a different perspective on it. And so we got to know each other that way, kind of like brother rebels without a cause. And I tell you, I use that book all the time. I refer to it, and George has a quote on my book. The one book I never leave at the boathouse or something like that.
Yeah, I never lend it out.
Yeah, all right. So we're buddies. Okay, so George is going to talk about how to coach coxswains. Good luck.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me today. I do have to say, you know, for Mike, he was a mentor to me when I wrote my book initially. I modeled it off his Nuts and Bolts guide. I wanted to create something fun and interesting to read on, let's face it, a somewhat dry subject. Not everything with rowing is all that exciting and, you know, day to day. Coxing can be, you know, a little dry. So I wanted to create something exciting. When I first started as a coxswain, I was basically dropped in a boat, expected to go out, learn how to do what we do as coxswains, and that was about it. And this is with a coach that actually was a huge proponent of coxswains. You know, day to day, you know, anywhere he went, conventions, he was, you know, putting coxswains on a pedestal. But still, he didn't necessarily coach them like... to the most value. And so when I created the book, I wanted to create something that kind of took away the mystery and made it easier for everybody else, you know, following along behind me to learn. And so that's where I come from. So what I hope to do today is you know, talk to you a little bit about the holistic side of coaching coxswains. And what I found is really interesting here listening to the other speakers is how much the same message is being presented to you all today, to us, because I, you know, I'm learning here today as well. The same messages from person to person, and hopefully you'll pick up on those themes as I go through my presentation. So this is my mantra. It seems pretty simple, but you know, we spend an inordinate amount of time going over the rowing stroke, going over training, and trying to raise our rowers to the highest level, but we can't forget our coxswains. You know, you're putting 9 people out, not 8. And you want your coxswain, who's the linchpin, the person that you're putting a lot of trust in, to carry your rowers, you know, to their potential, you know, hopefully at the finish line with a gold medal for you guys. So it's important that we train them to the same level and not dismiss them as the extra people in the boathouse. At least that's my take. You know, I'm biased. I'm a coxswain. So, you know, a well-trained coxswain is the one that's going to get you the results. And, you know, the one that you take time to train is going to get you the results you want. You know, they're going to come home with the gold medals, if you're lucky. I'm going to relate a little bit of a story here. I had a young lady a number of years ago that came into our team from a different program. She transferred in, and she came right to us in the spring. And so she had some coxing under her belt, you know, not our base level training. And she was unique, and we worked with her as best we could throughout the year. And it got to championship season, and we had to make a decision. She ended up in a boat that had potential to do really, really well. So we sent them out, and they're, you know, cruising down the course. We expect them to do, you know, easily qualify for the final. And they are just squeaking in. We're like, you know, what happened? These, you know, they've been hot all week. So, you know, we come in, we debrief the crew, and we chat, and, you know, the girl's a little reserved, and at some point the coxswain wanders off like she always did. And so then the girls are like, you would not believe what happened out there. She didn't tell us anything. She didn't tell us the 500-meter marks. She didn't tell us where the other crews were. So this group of girls made it to the final despite her. And so, you know, what are we going to do? I can't pull her, you know. So we did what we had to do. We told the girls, look, lock onto your stroke, follow her down the course, move when she moves, do your darndest, and everything will work out. And it did. It did. They ended up coming in with a third place medal. Now, this seems very negative about a coxswain, contrary to my story, but what this is a cautionary tale that you have to develop your coxswains from the very beginning, from the ground floor up. And you know, sometimes you're not able to do that with every individual. You've got to do the best you can. But if you take the time with the people that you have from the very beginning, you're going to find results. All right. So what defines a great coxswain? I'm sure a lot of you have ideas. Hopefully many of you have thought about it. You know, clearly they're leaders, right? You know, however you might define that, how Matt was defining it in his presentation just a minute ago. You know, they're the people that get out there and get the job done when you need them to. You know, your coxswains, you want somebody that's a really good set of eyes and ears in the boat. You know, they're motivators, they're tacticians. And most importantly, I think, they're the people that you need to trust when you shove that boat off the dock, right? Because all of a sudden they've got, you know, 8 other lives in their hands, and they've got, you know, a $40,000 boat and a mission. And so, you know, their preparation, what you do to help them, to mentor them, is critical. So, what kind of person are you looking for? Do you want Napoleon? This is kind of the, you know, what everybody thinks of. Short, loud, and bossy. Okay, if you train the short, loud, bossy person, that's the kind of activity, that's the kind of leader that you're going to get on the water. And I think that there's more to that as a coxswain than just those simple things. Size isn't everything. Just because you're small doesn't mean that you have the other tools to do the job. It is kind of a key to the door. I was a coxswain, but I'm kind of on a high end here. You're looking for people who, straight off the bat, are athletes and they're competitors, because those are the people that know what it feels like to push through pain, to push through hard moments in a practice. And so they can relate better to your athletes. They're intelligent, they're thoughtful. You know, when you have a conversation with them, you know, even high schoolers, you're getting something back. They communicate well. I mean, that is absolutely critical for a coxswain, you know, both with their athletes, but also with you. You need to be able to relate things back and forth and know that you're getting through. They're positive, and they're multitaskers, right? That is something that not everybody's good at. It's something that you can learn, but, you know, you think about the position of being a coxswain, you are juggling a lot of things. You're steering boats. You're calling practices. You're relaying information to your rower or your rowers, and, you know, taking all this feedback in while keeping track of weather, other crews, obstacles. It's a lot. And, you know, experience teaches this to a certain degree, but you'll also find those people right off, you know, that are capable. You know, my own personal story is that when I started off as a coxswain, I was the organized guy. I was the guy that, was enthusiastic and dedicated, but I was also fairly timid, quite honestly. You know, I didn't have a lot of confidence, and I spent most of my high school career in the third and fourth eight, just plugging along, not sure quite why I was there. And then senior year, I got dropped into a boat with four other random rowers, and something clicked. And I ended up coming home with a national championship. The light bulb went on for me. But, you know, what happened really was that my coach kept working with me, kept mentoring me, kept fostering me and bringing me along and waiting for the right moment where I could really excel and exceed when I was ready. And that's something that we have to do, is we have to be kind of cognizant that, okay, you may not find the perfect person to begin with, but you've got to have the insight to know that you can develop them. Okay? Some kids will present, and you're just like, you got to give them time. Okay. So, for coaches to really succeed, you got to give them an environment of, an environment of success. You got to give them a space where they can build their confidence and feel good about what they're doing. If they come into a situation where they're always getting yelled at, they're always getting creamed from one side or the other, they're not going to push their boundaries. They're more than likely going to kind of fold in on themselves. You know, some kids will push through anyway, but, you know, as high school coaches, which I am, I coach at Washington Lee High School in Arlington, you know, we're there to raise kids up, not, you know, sweep them aside. So you got to give them room to grow, make mistakes. And one important part of that is making sure that they are considered an equal part of the team. A lot of times, you know, I alluded to it earlier, some coaches, some squads just kind of dismiss the coxswains as the extras. And that's not fair. And that doesn't send a good message, you know, across your team. You know, everybody on your team is a valuable athlete. At least that's how we look at it at Washington Lee. So, you know, the wording, how you present, you know, coxswains to your athletes, the rowing side, is critical. Because in the end, when you send them out, you want the rowers to know that the coxswains are equal and that they are there for them and vice versa, okay? Flip side is, you know, be careful that, you know, you don't put your coxswains on a pedestal and make them some kind of little Bengalis or, you know, somehow above the rest of the boat, because that's not the case either. You know, everybody is equal. Everybody makes something happen. So we work really hard, and I would suggest this, to define the expectations and roles of what your coxswains are and do from the very, very beginning. When we get our coxswains and we bring them in, even now with winter conditioning, they are, you know, we sit them down, we explain, you know, what is your job? You know, what are you going to do every day? What are you going to do here, winter conditioning? What are you going to do on the water? And why? And then from there, you know, we start having them shadow the experienced coxswains, the coaches. They immediately start learning about technique and how to run practices, how to phrase things, you know, how to start a piece on the erg, you know, attention go, something we take for granted, but they need to learn. And if they learn it with you early on from the very beginning, and that's ingrained through every day, then when race day comes, it's not a surprise. And none of these things are surprises. You know, we also make sure that they understand that they're extensions of the coaches. They are not coaches, but they, you know, work with us, you know, in a capacity that allows them to do many of the things we do in terms of working on technique, you know, running the practices, et cetera. We make sure that we don't try and teach them like I was taught, which is through osmosis. We're very hands-on, and I would recommend that too. So we ask questions, you know, we quiz them daily. You know, we expect them to really think about what they're doing, and we help them do that. You know, again, in our winter conditioning sessions now, you know, we've been going since November, it's pretty much our varsity coxswains that are running winter conditioning. I mean, certainly the coaches are there. We give them the workouts, tell them, you know, how the day is generally going to go. But then we set them free. They run the warm-up. They run the dynamic stretching. They oftentimes run the mental training. They get them over, get the rowers set up on the ergs, get the ergs, you know, the monitors set up, get them started, write down the scores, you know. So all, you know, even the youngest coxswains can take part in that, and they start doing that as well, you know, writing down the scores and keeping track of information and inputting it. Okay, so the responsibility is there from the very beginning, and we foster that all the way through, because you're going to send them out, again, on the water. If they could do it on land, if you can train them on land to do that, then when they hit the water and you set them free, you can have the confidence that they're going to do what you need them to do, or at least hope that they're going to do. Okay, so communication and feedback. And I think Michael liked this, because, you know, we talked about GoPros last night. The first thing I want to say is how you interact with your coxswains can be one of two ways. You can come from the school of yelling and, you know, why didn't you do that? I just told you, why didn't you execute that? Why didn't you make that turn? What? And, you know, driving them, you know, into a safe place where they're going to hide. Or you can do what we try and do, which is, you know, help them out. We make small corrections during practice, say on the water. But then, you know, when we stop, everybody stops between pieces, and we chat with our crew. Okay, we take a moment to, I always take a moment to go to my coxswain and say, you know, you did this really well. I heard you say this. Maybe next time do X, Y, or Z. Say this. When we do the next piece, I want you to do this. And then when we come in off the water, you know, everybody usually debriefs their boat. Well, I debrief the coxswains as well. You know, we send the rowers off, coxswains and I get together and we chat and figure things out. What went well? What went wrong? What are we going to work on tomorrow? What did they see? Because I really want their feedback of what they're feeling and seeing in the boat, since I'm not in it. Which, that was also mentioned today, and as being a coxswain, there's no, one of the best places is to be in the boat. And most of us, you know, don't have that advantage. So they're the lifeline to that. Now, giving them feedback, the GoPro, by far, would probably be, Mike, I would say that would be my new innovation, right? Well, yesterday I thought, you know, Coxbox, but then, you know, I thought later, it's definitely the GoPro. And the reason why is, you know, the standard was to record coxswains, record voice, you know, either an audio recorder, phone, whatever. And then sit back, and you're sitting in some dusty part of the boathouse listening to this little tape recorder. And it's like, oh, you said that. But it's not in context. With video, you're getting the audio and what's happening in the moment all together. And as you sit down, as we do at WNL with our coxswains, and we're going through these practice pieces or these races most likely, You can stop on a particular moment. When you see something happening, you can say, why did you say this? Why did you do that? You know, maybe you could have said it this way. What was happening with this other crew that you didn't even mention? Okay? You can discuss it and then move on and really kind of, you know, make it a conversation that makes sense, because just audio is just, it's just out here. It's just words. So if you can, get a GoPro, find some space to sit down with your coxswains and really experiment with them. So you will yell from time to time at your coxswains, and that's okay. But if you set up the right environment, like we try and do, then they know that it's not personal. Pretty much the beginning of every year, I say to them, it's not personal if I yell at you. I'm going to get frustrated. You're going to get frustrated. When we come off the water, everything's zeroed. Let's talk out. Let's figure out what's going on. And that way, they feel, again, safe to grow. You know, and we know high school kids take everything personally. So, you know, lastly, as I'm closing out, you know, we could talk mechanics and practical skills, which 18 minutes doesn't allow, and I'm going to go over a sec. You know, I would say add responsibility incrementally. So you have to know your coxswains. You know, give them that little piece. Don't expect them to run, you know, 3x1500, you know, with these ratings and those ratings and this changes and all that. Start off simple. Just have them steering the boat, all right? You know, you're going to have to teach them commands and steering and technique and running practices and drills, okay? But I'm not going to tell you about those things today. I can't do it in 18 minutes. What I'd really like to see you all do is go out, find a book, find some good articles, talk to some great coxswains and coaches. Read it and absorb it from the perspective of a coxswain, just like you would if you were researching rowing technique. All right? And if you do that, then you're going to be able to think and give back to the coxswain just like they're going to learn it, right? Which is far more valuable. And the best part is you're going to be able to say all these things in your own voice, which is going to be stronger than if you tried to mimic me, you know, and what I would tell you today. So in essence, I'm coaching you to coach yourself, to coach coxswains today. But if anybody needs any advice ever, you just ring me up, and I've got plenty of stories and things to go. Great.
Thanks.
And there you go. I love it. I love it.
So GoPro, let me talk about this real quick. For $1.29, you can get the camera, and for $28, you can get this whole dribble drabble set that goes with it, include a super annoying selfie stick and X, Y, and Z. Is it worth it? I think it's one of the best investments that you could spend money on. Instead of the $40,000 Resolute, the kidding Resolute, instead of $40,000, $1.29, and you get just go to Amazon on GoPro. It doesn't have the Wi-Fi at this doll rate, but you don't need the big doll rate. And instead of just taking this and looking at the clock, or having it on the coxswain head the whole time, is, as we talked about last night, put it on the little suction cup, put it in the launch, turn around, and watch your film yourself. You want to become a better coach? Film yourself. Jack, we're going to try to get you up here in a second, see if we can get the head of the Charles thing up for you, just real quick. What? Oh, no. No, don't show that. Horrible. Okay. We've got an 8-minute break. So, stretch. We're on the home stretch. Two to go. It's the seventh inning. Great job. catch any from the back down?
Yeah.
Great, thanks.
You hear me? Very good.
Smartest, best looking, funny speakers coming. How's that for pressure? And one of the few that has less hair than I do. How's that?
That's good.
Better. There
I
we
live
go.
With that.
Okay. I've known Greg for a couple years, and Greg works with Croker and for Croker, and there's a lot of innovation. Part of Max Rigging and such, I don't promote any equipment over any other because people work really, really hard. I know how hard the manufacturers work and what they're doing. This looks really stupid. and what they're doing with their stuff. Croker is innovative, as is Concept 2, and there's certainly other ore companies out there. But I've asked Greg to come in, and he certainly jumped on it, so I didn't have to twist his arm, to talk about fleet management, equipment, and such. They're doing some neat things, and I thought it was really interesting. Greg's been coaching how long?
About 20 years.
20 years. Okay, Greg Doyle. Okay, you're on.
Thanks.
Okay.
And I'm on sound, right? Okay. Just for those of you who don't know me, I'm Greg Dawe. I work with Croker Ores. This morning when I came in and Mike started this and he started assigning the one word, I think I panicked about that for most of the morning and afternoon, thinking, does he know me well enough to get it right, or does he know me so well that he gets it right? And either side of that is, you know, it's always a little nervous. In working with Croker Ores, I get to visit a lot of boathouses and talk with a lot of coaches. And one of the things you certainly discover as you're trying to sell somebody your product is just how hard it is to manage all the equipment in the boathouse, to have the money to be able to invest in equipment that you think will make your cruise go faster. And I've been in the sport 30 years myself. I was always fascinated by equipment. I remember first trying to rig up old wooden oars to make them all alike because that seemed to make sense rather than having ones that were at different settings when I was 15. Then we discovered it wasn't the equipment, it was us that wasn't going fast. But still, I knew that there had to be a sense of organization to equipment, a plan that you execute against. Because for the most part, you want to get out on the water, grab your megaphone, and work with the athletes. You don't want to necessarily have to deal with the equipment. But you can't get around it. It's not the most durable equipment. We're lucky if we get 10 to 20 years out of a piece of equipment, but it lives a pretty tough life, and we want to make sure that we obviously get as much money as we can out of it
and that we're spending money the right way. So first I'll start with rowing as a sport is obviously heavily equipment dependent. In fact, that's pretty much what we do. We've come a long way since the old ferryman gigs out there where you just pulled on the oars and sat on the bench seat. We've moved on to sliding seats, fixed outriggers, rotating oar locks. We moved from wood into composites. And then along the way, at every turn that we could put adjustability into riggers, into oars, into oar locks, we've done that as well. So as a coach, you have a lot of stuff to balance when you look across your fleet. You may be lucky enough to have a fleet that's all one brand, all one model, but most of us probably have a little mix of a piece from this coach, a piece from that coach, and you've inherited some of it, and staying on top of it is a pretty difficult task. As much as you would like to get out with the megaphone and get out in the boat and just make it about the athletes and perfect technique, you do have plenty to do. You have, you know, literally, if you embrace it, it's a gearhead's paradise. You can set your rowers tight. You can set your rowers wide. You can lengthen them out. You can load them up. You can ease them up. All things that allow you to maybe coach a certain style over another, or just maximize the strength of one particular group within your overall program. But it is a challenge to your daily management, your day-to-day operations. Do you only have, say, 85 to 120 minutes with the athletes? And obviously, if you need to be attending to equipment for a good 20 or 30 minutes, it's probably not the best way to get through a practice. In dealing with equipment, there's sort of three sides to it. One, you can get a gain out of it. Two, you can get a loss out of it. Or two, you can just sort of keep pace. If you get it right, there's a good chance you make your crews faster. You optimize their performance. You get them, you know, a little bit more through the pin. You get them a little bit more aggressive through the finish. Whatever you're trying to do, you know, there's a setting. You can tweak it, and you can play with it. At the very least, when you're certainly piecing two boats and evaluating personnel, you want the equipment that they're using to be fair and consistent. You don't want a person to feel that they lost a seat race, if you still do that, or lost out on a chance to move up to the next level in the program because the equipment they were in for that one piece wasn't so hot. So you want to bring a certain element of consistency of the equipment that's going to involve tweaking it because you're not going to have two pieces that are exactly alike in many cases. You're going to have to do your best to get parity to some degree between the equipment. And it is a coaching distraction. It is time that you have to spend away from the megaphone and from the athlete. You do need to carve away that time. You can either do it, you know, as a band-aid approach, every time something goes wrong, you got to fix it. That, because it's unplanned, it's going to disrupt your schedule. Or you can sort of set aside the time, do it ahead, know full well going into a practice what you can expect from your equipment. There are variables, they are constant, and it's a wise person who understands the difference. You need to understand what you can fix, tweak, and change. As much as you would like to make two different brands, two different shapes of hull or blade, the same or comparable for a practice, there's a limitation to what you can do. You can make it feel similar, parts of it, but it's a very good possibility that you're just going to get close. And you just have to understand that there are limits to that. Don't assume, if you do happen to have two pieces of equipment that at some point in time are exactly the same, don't assume in the program that they age the same. The two boats that you bought at exactly the same time in 2005, one may have taken a different path in its life. It may have gotten a little bit more abuse than the other. So just because they were equal at one time, don't assume that that stays constant throughout the life of the equipment that you have. Once you've sorted out, what you can change, you do want to abandon the set it and forget it mentality. You always want to constantly be going back and refreshing and getting into the equipment. Keep your hand in it. You want to have an understanding of it as it is, not as it was or as you remember it. You really want to have sort of a live read on that equipment, at the very least from season to season, but possibly depending on your equipment, even month to month. Once you decide that you've done all you can do, there's still going to be some differences, and you need to accept those differences. But the bottom line is you really want to have an ownership mentality. And I say row it like you own it, even if it's not really yours. But live in that equipment. Don't wish you had something else. Learn what you have and get it to work the way you want it to work. And I borrowed a nice little picture from the internet there. As much as geeks would appreciate that stormtroopers are all supposed to be the same, as much as you look, there's a million different things you can pick out that are different as you look down that crew. And it just says, just because things look the same or you sort of remember them or expect them to be the same, don't necessarily assume that that's true. As you look over your equipment, know what you have, brands, vintages. Make sure you have a parts inventory that's appropriate to that. You may have one boat that's been there for 10, 15 years, and maybe you haven't had to do anything to it. But if you suddenly break apart and decide that you do need to fix it, you want to make sure you have it on hand. So you want to take an inventory and get a sense of the things that you might need. That includes special tools or materials. Fittings change constantly in boat makers and in oar makers. So you want to make sure you have the right tools to adjust oars, to adjust boats, and basically to set the equipment to your liking. Once you know what you have, you also need to know what you need. You're taking stock of what you have, but you're also thinking about, what am I going to add to this in the future? And is it going to make sense, or is it going to complicate my life? Where is your program heading? Are you going to be doing sweep? Are you going to be doing sculls? Are you going to be big boats or small boats? Unfortunately, there's really only two boats that are interchangeable. One boat, but two boats when you describe it as interchangeable. But pair doubles. You know, if you have a double, it can be a pair. If you have a pair, it can be a double. But we really don't have too many Cox quads races. We don't have too many Cox octuple races. So your eights and fours are pretty much generally eights and fours. And there's not too many straight four races for junior rowers. So your quads are pretty much quads. So if your plan for the program changes, you need to make sure that your equipment can sort of grow with you. I see this more in programs that are in the beginning, because the numbers are smaller, sculling, but then they want to move towards sweep. Well, your doubles are going to be useful pairs, but how many people really send out junior pairs? It's not a big number. And then, obviously, as you're taking stock of what you have and where you want to go, you want to make sure that within the program, the boosters, your fellow coaches, and your administrators, that you have allies. They have to share that vision, because you don't want to sit there and make changes and discover that they're going to make changes back the other way. Annual boathouse review, I think, is a minimum, just to get a sense of what you have, how it performed for you this year. You want to identify your workhorses, you want to flag the problems, and you need to debate the idle. If a piece of equipment isn't getting used, what are you going to do with it? Is it useful to somebody else? Can you find a use for it? We'll talk about that in a little bit more detail. You want input from all the coaches. If you're the varsity coach, or you're the program director, or you're the novice coach, there's a good chance there's two or three other perspectives in your program that you may not necessarily be aware of. And your athletes can help with that as well. If it's at all possible, row it yourself. There's nothing like getting in the boat, discovering what your athletes discover on a daily basis. Okay, if they get in that boat and it's impossible to move the foot stretchers, now you have a pretty good understanding of why it takes 10, 15 minutes to sort of get that first stroke in after launching off the dock. You getting into the boat yourself is going to give you the best picture. If not, I recommend rotating your experienced athletes through the entire spectrum of the fleet. These are the people that normally row your top boats. Put them in the bottom boats a couple times and ask them, okay, what's wrong with this? What didn't you like about it? Because the reality is the future varsity people come from the novices. And if they can give you a perspective on what the novices are seeing, but with a better vocabulary, you can make decisions for the bottom half of your fleet that you don't lose people who just got tired of just the frustration of getting out and getting equipment ready to row. You build a knowledge base with your athletes. That's awesome. They become better coaches someday. They take that with them. But the other thing is that within the program, there's a sense of trust and ownership. They feel like they're part of the program instead of just an athlete at your beck and call. When it comes to the fleet workhorses, you want to keep good records on it. Why? Because these are the boats that you love. Why do you love them? You want to make sure you're writing this stuff down. What makes this equipment vital? Learn the parts life cycle. What should you be changing out every 4 years, every 8 years, every 12 years, or beyond? You want to communicate with the manufacturer. Is there something about the design, or is there something coming up that you may want to consider if you're looking at a refurb or a refit? And then, are there any unique parts or special care? Did you buy the boat in 2005 and they never made them like that, and they never made them like that again? You want to make sure you're not holding on to a white elephant that you can't necessarily deal with without some major intervention. The most important thing is you want to keep them healthy. They are your workhorses. This is what gets the job done every day for your program. So you want to make sure that you're maintaining it, you're investing in it over long-term periodic points. And then, again, you're building within your athletes a culture of stewardship. You want them to care for the boats as much as you care for them, because without them, they're pretty much sitting around just rowing ergs. So you need the boats to be working for you, although this obviously applies to ergs, too. For the ones that are problems, you need to answer to similar questions as to why the boats were good. If the boat is a problem, why is it difficult? Is it an understanding or familiarity problem? Is this the only boat you have like that brand, and the foot stretchers are just so different? I have a wing rigger boat, and if I want to change the foot stretchers, I got to pull the whole wing off the boat to be able to do that. It's probably not going to make a very good on-the-water change, You may have situations with your fleet equipment where it's a little bit harder to adjust than maybe the generic model you have across the rest of your fleet. Is it a particular boat that just underwent poor maintenance or abuse? Are there design challenges? Is it something that they got wrong at the manufacturer that, hey, they've admitted they can fix it, but they don't necessarily, you know, get in contact with every coach or every place that boat has landed, and it's a boat waiting to be fixed. So you want to find out if that is the case. And then the last one is, if you really can't answer any of the top three or four questions, is there just sort of a nondescript incompatibility with the program? It just doesn't work for us. It's okay to write that down, just haven't found where this particular boat fits. It's good to keep a record of these things because keeping it in your head, well, you know, you get distracted, you have other things. If you write it down, you're recording it, there's a narrative to this boat. This boat has sort of a history, almost a bit of a provenance, and you can make better decisions about that equipment when it comes time to possibly debate it. For equipment that is idle in your program, why is it idle? Do you have low numbers this year? Is this a boat that was there when you got there and you haven't touched it since? Is this somebody else's problem that you inherited? Will you need it in the future? And ultimately, what's the value, either to yourself within the program, or what's the value to somebody else who might want to acquire it, who might need that? With equipment cares, a couple key things that you need to think about. There's the storage of the equipment, the regatta and training travel, daily upkeep, the seasonal and periodic tasks, and then again, sort of wrapping it up in the team culture of stewardship and caring for equipment. With storage, as I go through my travels, I'm amazed at the number of programs that store stuff outside. And really, no matter what a boat is made of, no matter what color it is, UV exposure over the long term is bad, and that rots boats. I've seen it rot oars. I've seen it turn black oars white, and then when you grab the shaft, you can just feel the whole thing crunch underneath you. That's actually a white oar. Very simple idea, taking the black shaft and painting it white with a two-part epoxy. But if you know you're going to be storing your Learn to Row equipment outside, probably not a bad idea to consider painting the shafts or getting them painted by the manufacturer. Tarps. Are a minimum. You know, fitted covers are expensive. That's awesome if you can get them. But tarps, just cover stuff. Just cover stuff. You'll have to replace them probably once every year or two, but keep stuff out of UV. And then, of course, we are a water sport, but it's amazing how vulnerable our parts and fittings are to water, moisture, and ultimately salt. As much as something might be stainless, it's only stainless for a little while. And eventually you get salt intrusion, and you begin to see a little bit of rust stains on stuff. And wood, wonderful material, but when it gets wet and stays wet for a very long time, it swells, and then it cracks when it dries out. And then the fabrics on grips, we'll get to that in a little bit, but those are things that we need to take care of. When equipment was all wood and we just sort of left it out, it was fine. Equipment travel, trailer miles and conditions, and temporary site challenges. As much as a new trailer might look great, a couple years later, those arms aren't all perfectly aligned. You're going to put this nice, stiff boat and lash it down and then drive it through 2,000 miles of road vibrations and uneven terrain when you get to the regatta site. Probably not the best thing for boats. So whatever might wear a boat in storage situations, travel, I think, is really the death miles for boats. Loss and damage, you just need to get a sense of when you're going to go traveling, you're going to come back and there's going to be less parts than when you got there. You can try to have a good culture about it and keep kids on it, but stuff just gets damaged in travel. Who can tell me what's wrong with that picture? That won't take too much time. Yeah, very good, very astute. They're not all croquerores. Most importantly, and the thing that concerns me the most, is you have the hard polymer collars up against the bare shafts. That's in the bed of a trailer. That's going to ride 2,000 miles vibrating the whole trip. As much as you tie it down, it still finds a way to vibrate. And that hard plastic is going to sort of score the shafts. So if you learn nothing else, when you're loading oars in the trailer, you want to have collars and sleeves and collars and sleeves. Stack them nicely, get all OCD about it, but sort of the random arrangement there is not going to help you. Daily upkeep, post-workout cleaning, sanitary concerns. You saw Deb's presentation on blisters. Wonderful to see one of my customers in travel brought the bleach with them. Hopefully they were changing it on a daily basis. But this is a set of oars that's almost 10 years old, and for the most part, you look at those handles, they're taking pretty good care of it. You get more longevity out of the equipment, your plastic parts, your rubber parts, you need to lubricate, wheels, collars, sleeves, oar locks. And the daily upkeep, the great part about that is communication. You're intervening every single day. The kids are cleaning stuff. They're looking at stuff. And if they spot something, they can tell you. Periodic tasks. Believe it or not, somebody actually rode on that the day I received it. I asked, was this just sitting in the yard for a while? He goes, no, I rode this morning. I'm not sure what he was doing, but I'm very confident it was not rowing. But that sleeve is, you know, it's been left out in the sun. It's eaten through to the glue. These are the periodic things we need to address, these wearable parts, real cleaning, stripping down, reassembling stuff, oars, wheels on seats, shoes, just never really seem to last as long as they should. And as you do those things, you want to update the records, keep that narrative of the boats going. What have you done lately with it? And yet, with a team culture of good equipment, good health, good performance, it's really, when you look at the equipment and you look at the culture of the team, you got to find that both are thriving or both are decaying. And usually one will pull the other down or pull the other up. From that, once you, there's just a nice little quick thing on handles here. With the TSP, as much as you bleach on a daily basis, the TSP pulls out the organic grime that you leave behind. So you can see here, two dirty handles, very nicely with a little bit of elbow grease, become a clean handle. And that's why we do it, because you don't want to sit there and row that dirty handle if that's what your hands look like. No, 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 I don't. So what that comes down to, very quickly, care first, then spend second. Once you take care of what you have, then you deserve to spend money. Standard model of fleet turnover is buy new and pass down. That's great, but that has some challenges to it. You want a regular schedule. Your budget becomes semi-predictable. It does require good maintenance, especially on the bottom end, depending on the interval, how often you're buying. You want to recognize that elite equipment is not always ideal for novices. It may be too light. It may be built for racing, but not for crabbing and smashing into docks. And you don't want your lower boats to necessarily suffer an age class discrimination. Just because you're going to buy new, don't not take care of the boats at the bottom end. Boat value and depreciation pretty much goes like that. I sort of have a high, mid, and a low. And over time, you see that our $40,000 boat at the high end, 20 years later, you're lucky if you get 14 grand. On the low end, maybe worth 5 grand. I did just a few quick turnover schedules. We'll go through them very quickly. All scenarios assume 20 years. A new boat is 40, and a standard four-boat fleet. And then what I did is I just did the mid-range depreciation of 7.5% a year and an annual price increase of 2%, and assume no other influences. We can see here every 4 years, you're spending about, if you average it over the years, you're spending about $8,400. But your oldest boat is 16 years old. Every 2 years, you're spending on average about $11,000, but your average boat is only 8 years old. And if you do it every year, not too many programs doing that, you're spending about $13,000 annual, and your average boat is 4 years. If you make one minor change to that, split your program in half, and avoid passing equipment below the midpoint, you can have elite equipment, you got novice equipment, and you can take care of each. That's the hook? All right. But just very quickly, yeah, you end up going, instead of spending the $8,000, you're spending roughly around $5,400, and the money that you save can be put into taking care of the lower half. Every 2 years, you're only spending $6,400 on an annual spend, and every year, you're spending about $7,000 if you really wanted to change boats out every year. That's pretty much, you know, the basic math of it. I know you were told there would be no math on the test, but there's a little bit. You want to make sure that when you're spending money, that you're spending it wisely, and any opportunity to save money, you can reinvest into your program. About the only other thing I would add is that in terms of a retrofit, if you're looking at a professional repair, a full refitting of a boat, you're probably looking somewhere around $4,500 to $7,000 to get a boat truly refitted and ready for another grand tour of usage. So it's just something to consider in your numbers. That's it. I have more info if you want to look at it at another time, but I didn't quite rehearse and I went over the 18 minutes. But thank you very much.
Thanks, Jeff.